Hi, I'm Jay Leeming, and this is the Crane Bag Podcast for June 2019. Today we're going to be looking at the beautiful but surprisingly merciless story that many of us know as Sleeping Beauty. Once upon a time, there were a king and a queen who wanted to have a child but had no child. Every day the sun would rise and the world would seem all fresh and new again, and they would think to themselves, "Oh, how we wish we had a child," but still there was no child in their lives. But one day the queen was bathing in a pool in the palace garden, when a frog hopped out of that pool and began to speak. And the frog said, "Oh, my queen, have no fear. You shall have a child within a year." And the frog hopped away. Well, it turned out that what the frog said was true. Within a year, the queen gave birth to a beautiful baby girl. A beautiful baby girl. And the king and the queen were so happy. So happy, they decided to have a great party, a great feast. They decided to invite all their friends and family to a great feast at their castle. So the invitations went out, and they invited everybody they knew. They also invited the 13 wise women of that kingdom. Now these wise women were strong, formidable, powerful ladies. There were many stories about them. They were very mysterious, but people told stories. They said that some of them could speak to the wind, that others could know spells that would make the mushrooms grow fatter and tastier. Some said they knew the dreams of the rocks and the stones. Some said they had spells that could let them fly and change the course of events, make it rain, make the sun shine. All kinds of crazy stories were said. No one knew much about them. But they were strong, and they were magical, and they were mysterious. So the invitations went out to them as well. And then in the castle, the king and the queen and all their servants began to get that place ready. They began to clean that castle out. They made the banquet hall ready. Down in the kitchen, all kinds of things were happening. The cook was getting all kinds of cakes and things ready. They were preparing to roast a giant ox there. All kinds of things happening. And in the banquet hall, the king was looking over everything to make sure it was all right. And he noticed something. They had a table for the wise women, but they only had 12 golden plates. 12 plates shining just like the sun. 12 of them, but only 12. And there were 13 wise women. So he said to himself, "This'll never do. This can't happen." So they sent a message to the 13th wise woman. And the message was, "We're sorry, you cannot come." And they left it at that. Well, the preparations went on. They got ready, and finally the big day arrived, and everyone came to that castle. And it was a beautiful sunny day. The flags on the top of the castle were blowing in the wind. And in that great banquet hall, well, the bards, they sang songs. They sang songs and told stories about the beginning of the world and the creation of all things, and about the princess who was born inside a clamshell. And there was feasting and song, and the ox was cooked, and there was cake, and it was a great party. It's an amazing party. People got drunk even. They toppled around telling jokes that hadn't been told for 1,000 years, that were hilarious and funny, and made even the potatoes split open and crackle with laughter. And then at one point, there came a moment when all the wise women began to stand up one by one and give blessings to the baby girl. And these blessings were so beautiful. The words they spoke were so mingled and woven with the air of that moment that, well, it seemed like these were actually spells that were happening right there. They were taking place right there in that place. One wise woman gave the baby girl beauty. Another gave her wisdom and intelligence. Another gave her strength. One gave her luck. They all gave these things to the baby girl. And the 11th wise woman had just spoken and just sat down, when suddenly the door slammed open, and in came the 13th wise woman, and she was angry. She had a look on her face like storm clouds, and her dress was purple and black, and there was a red lightning bolt across it, and she went to the middle of the room, and she said, "I have a gift for this child as well, and my gift is this. On her 15th birthday, she shall prick her finger on the spindle of a spinning wheel and fall down stone dead, just like that." And she turned and she stormed out. And everyone was quiet. Everyone was quiet. And there was a feeling in the air as though ashes were falling down into that room. ashes perhaps from a fire burning high up on the surface of the moon. But the last, the 12th wise woman, had not yet spoken. So she stood up, and she said, "I cannot stop this spell, but I can soften it, for my gift is this. On her 15th birthday, this beautiful baby girl, she'll prick her finger on the spindle of a spinning wheel and fall asleep for 100 years. And then she sat down. And people breathed out a little bit. They felt a little bit better, but still it was a scary event that had happened there. So people, you know, drank and ate a little bit more, and then everyone went home. But the next day, the king declared that all the spindles in that kingdom should be brought to that castle. And they piled them up there in front of the castle, and they burned them all in a huge bonfire. The ashes rose up into the sky and drifted away, carried on the wind to distant lands. Well, the king felt better after that. Many other people felt better, too. There's no spindles in this kingdom. How can she prick her finger? That'll never happen. And so the years went by, and the baby girl grew up, and she had a wonderful childhood. It was just terrific. All the gifts that the wise woman had given to her seemed to come true. She was beautiful, she was strong, she was lucky, she all kinds of things. She had a wonderful childhood, many friends. There was enough shadow and enough light in her life through those years to make her grow into a wonderful young woman. And then her 15th birthday came. And on this morning, it was interesting, the king and the queen, they had gone out on a trip, and they were expected back that morning. But when she awoke, the princess was more or less alone in that place. There were servants around that place, of course, but she was more alone in that castle than she had ever been. And she was curious. She began to explore. She went down hallways. That castle was a big place. She went down hallways and corridors she'd never been before. She opened doors she'd never dared to open before, and she found all kinds of things. She found a room filled with maps, maps of the other world, of the future world, of the past, all kinds of amazing atlases and things in there. She found a room filled with ropes, the rope room. She found a room filled with chocolate. She explored that whole castle. Finally, she came to a tower, and she found herself walking up a spiraling stair. Up and up she went, until finally she came to a door at the top of that staircase. And there was a lock on that door, and there was a rusty key in that lock. And she reached out to touch that key, and all she did was barely touch it with her fingers when it sprang open, and the door swung open. And she looked into that tower, and she saw a beautiful thing. She saw a golden bed covered in a quilt, and this quilt had stories stitched into it. There was a picture there of a turtle with a young woman on it. There was a picture of gods up in the sky. There was a picture of a fox swimming across a lake with a chicken in its mouth. And beside the bed was a spinning wheel, and there was an old woman there working at that spinning wheel. "Hello, Granny," said the princess. "What are you doing there?" "Oh, my child, come in, come in. Look, yes, I am spinning. This is a spinning wheel, you see. I am taking the wool, and I am spinning it into yarn." "Oh, my dear, how does this work?" said the princess. "Oh, just like this. Look, here's the treadle on the floor. This is the wheel itself. You can see how it turns. Tuckata, wakata, tuckata, wakata. It turns like that. See, this is the wool, and this is the yarn I'm making. Oh, and here, this is the spindle. Would you like to touch the spindle?" "Yes, please." So the princess reached out and held the spindle. As she took hold of it, it pricked her finger. And she looked down, and she saw one drop of luminous, beautiful blood. And that was the last thing she saw for a long time. For her eyes fluttered shut like the wings of butterflies, and she fell down into the bed and into a deep sleep. Now the thing about her sleep was it was not just her sleep, but it spread out to fill the entire castle. For no sooner had she fallen asleep in that bed than the old woman there began to nod, and she fell asleep. And the spinning wheel slowed to a stop. Tuckata, wakata, tuckata, wakata. Downstairs in the entryway of the castle, the princess's parents, the king and the queen, they had just come in the door. They were there dressed in their fine, resplendent clothes, but they slumped to the floor and fell asleep. There was a girl there with some white towels for them to wash their faces from the dust of their journey, and she was reaching out to offer them to the king and the queen, and she fell asleep, and the white towels were strewn on the marble floor. There was a boy there with a bowl of water to help them wash their faces, and he just had time to set that bowl down when he too slumped into a heap on that floor and slept. Down in the kitchen, downstairs in the basement, all kinds of things were going on. The servant boy had just dropped a bowl of soup, and the cook was about to slap him. "Oh, you dumb serving boy!" But just like that, in mid-slap, the cook fell asleep, and the serving boy fell asleep beside the spilled soup. And the crackling of the fire in the hearth there, it came to a stop, and the fire stopped, and it slept. It stopped. And the flies buzzing in that kitchen, they fell asleep all at once on the wall. Just like that. Outside in the royal stables, there were horses out there, but they neighed once, and they fell asleep. And the doves on the roof of the castle, they tucked their heads under their wings, and they fell asleep. And the flags at the top of the castle, they stopped fluttering in the wind, and out there in the royal apple orchard, the wind was moving the boughs and branches of those trees up and down, but then it too stopped, and everything was still. So nothing moved in that whole castle. Everything fell into a deep sleep. And this sleep went on all day and all night. It went on for weeks, months. It went on for an entire year, and then another year. And the only thing that changed in this place, the only thing that altered in any way, was a small little rose bush that was growing beside the gate of that castle. All through that first summer it grew, while everything else slept. And then it slept through the winter, and the following summer the rose bush grew some more. Year by year that rose bush grew. After 10 years that rose bush had climbed up the wall of the castle and started to go across the moat. After 20 years, it had crossed the moat and climbed all the way to the top of the castle wall there, and was going inside the castle over the roofs of it. After 30 years, that rosebush was so big it had engulfed that entire castle and climbed over the towers of that castle as well. 40 years went by, 50 years, the rhythm of our lives, summer, winter, fall, spring, all these seasons dancing together, moving in a circle, the wheel of the year turning on its axle of silence and eternity. So the seasons went forward, and the rose bush grew through all of this time. Soon it was gigantic. Soon the rose bush had swallowed the entire castle. People walking by, they would see in the distance this great hill of a rose bush. And they would hear the buzzing and humming of the bees as they visited all those flowers, but they would see no castle. 50 years, 60, 70, 80, 90 years went by. During this time, young men, brave young men on strong horses with sharp swords, well, they'd heard the story about the princess possibly asleep inside what possibly might be a castle inside that rosebush, and they tried to get their way in there. They tried to slash and cut their way through that rosebush, but they failed. All of them failed. The rosebush had a way of entangling them. As they moved forward, it would grow around them, even as they walked there, and soon many of them died in that place. And the rose bush grew around the bones of those young men and the bones of their horses. Finally, this spell went on, and it was almost time for this spell to be finished. In fact, it was the day before this spell would be done forever, and it would begin to unravel. And on this day, a young man came into that kingdom. A young man much like all the others. He had a good strong horse, he had a sharp sword. He came into that kingdom looking for something dangerous to do, looking for mysterious places to go, risky things to accomplish in that place. And he found an inn in that kingdom, and he spent the night there. And that evening he was sitting by the crackling fire there, and there was an old man in that inn who was known for telling stories. And every night he would tell long stories about the acorn that grew the universe out of itself, and the angel with brown wings who played the banjo on the roof of old McAllister's barn over there, and about the green horse who died in that field but could be heard, the galloping of the hooves of this horse could be heard every night in November as it galloped through the fields, a ghost horse. And the old man told the story about the princess asleep in the castle inside the rosebush. Well, there might be a castle there, no one knows, but that's the story, he said. And when he said this story was like a seed, and a flower grew from this seed. It was like a spark, and a great fire blossomed out of that spark inside the chest of that prince. He heard that story, and he said, "Ah, That is the quest for me. That is the dangerous thing I want to do. So the next day, he got on his good horse, he saddled it up, he got his strong, sharp sword, and he headed out for that rosebush. He approached it, that giant, mountainous rosebush. Now, it was all in blossom. There were bees all humming and buzzing around that rosebush. The roses were of many different colors. The smell was outrageously amazing. It was a wind come from far off, telling only of good, sweet things, perhaps. But there were shadows in that rosebush as well. He looked inside. Perhaps he could see the bones in there, and the dark places of that rosebush that held and clenched young men and killed them. And he went to that rosebush, and he raised his sharp sword as he was about to cut through it. But an amazing thing happened. The rosebush opened of itself. The branches and the flowers spread to the side, and he was able, on his horse, to trot into that rosebush. He kept going. Carefully they went forward, and the rosebush parted before them, just like that, moving aside. Forward they went, down this sort of tunnel in the rosebush itself. Finally they looked ahead, and they saw. What did they see? Oh, it was a stone? What is that, a garden wall? No, wait a minute. That's a castle. There is a castle in here, he thought to himself. And he went to that castle wall, and he tied up his horse to one of the branches of the rosebush, and he began to climb that rosebush. It was hard going. There were giant thorns on this thing. They were almost 100 years old. He climbed up the side. His hands were bleeding from climbing up there, but he climbed up the wall of that castle, over the top of the wall, and down inside. Soon he found himself in the entryway of that castle, and he saw them there. He saw the king and the queen dressed in their resplendent clothes, asleep on the floor, the crown falling just off the king's head. He saw the young boy there, asleep on the floor beside his bowl of water. He saw the young girl asleep there beside the towels strewn on the marble stone. Then he went down to the kitchen. He explored that castle in the same way the princess had so many years before. And he found himself in that kitchen, and there was the cook, asleep with a snarl on his face. There was a serving boy, asleep with a bowl of soup spilled on the floor beside him. There was the fire, asleep in the hearth. There were the flies, asleep on the wall. He went out to the royal stable. He saw the horses asleep there. He looked up at the top of the castle. He saw the doves asleep on the roof, how the flag was not moving at all. He went out to the apple orchard, and he saw how the branches of those trees were completely still. And then he found his way to a spiraling stair in a tower of that castle. And he began to walk up that spiraling stair. Up and up he went, up those stairs. Finally he came to a door that was ajar. It had a rusty key in it, and the door was open. And he looked into that room, and there he saw the golden bed with the stories on its quilt. He saw the princess asleep on that bed, and the old woman at her spinning wheel asleep beside the bed. And then he walked. Without thinking, he walked into that room. He bent down, and he kissed the princess on her cheek. And her eyes fluttered open like the wings of butterflies, and she looked at the prince, and she smiled. Now downstairs in the entryway of the castle, the king and the queen, well, they awoke as well. The king put the crown on his head, he stood up, and the young boy, well, he awoke, he took the bowl of water and he held it out to them. He said, "Welcome home, my dear king and queen. Here is some water. Please wash the dust from your journey off of your faces." And the serving girl did the same thing. She awoke, she gathered up those towels, and she said, "Yes, yes, king and queen, here are these towels. Please wash your faces. You've had a long journey." Down in the kitchen, well, everything started moving down there. The cook awoke. He awoke with that snarl, and he said, "You dumb serving boy," and he slapped him just like that. "Ow," said the serving boy. And then the fire began to crackle and burn in the hearth, and the flies, they all awoke at the same time, bzzzt, and began buzzing around that kitchen. Out there in the stable, the horses awoke, and they shook themselves, and they looked around with their big, large, horsey eyes. And on the roof of that castle, the doves awoke, and they flew away. And out in the apple orchard, the boughs of the trees began to stir and whisper and move up and down. And then, down those spiraling stairs from that tower, came the princess and the prince, hand in hand, and they came down into the entryway of that castle, and they said, "Welcome home, mother and father, welcome home, my king and queen." And there was much rejoicing there. They were glad to see each other again. And the prince, well, he spent some time in that castle. He spent a while getting to know the princess there. And after a while, it was decided that they would be married. So there was a wedding. The magical words were said, knitting the two of them together, threading together their two families. And then there was a great feast afterwards. The bells were rung, the gongs were played, the harps were played, and all kinds of celebrating happened. The kitchen made all kinds of food. They roasted an ox yet again. There was cake, there was wine, amazing blue wine they brought up from the basement of that castle. There were bards singing long stories about the creation of the world and the end of the world and the adventures of all the people in that world. It was a beautiful moment, a beautiful party. And the king and the queen invited all 13 wise women of that kingdom. And all of them came. And well, I was at that party as well. And I was given a golden key. And I was told, if I rub this key, I will be able to become invisible anytime I want to. But on the way here, something happened on the train, in the Detroit airport, in the Bristol train station. I don't know, somewhere along the line, something went wrong. And that key was stolen or lost or it fell out of my luggage. Because I can't find it anywhere right now. And it would be nice to have, because sometimes it is helpful to be able to become invisible. But I will have to do without it. So all I have for you is this story. Thank you for listening to this story. May it feed and nourish you. May it be a seed blossoming in your life. May you water it with your attention. And may there be great flowers rising up and singing out of this story, perhaps, in all of our futures. Thank you for listening to this story.